welcome you and invite you to our Lord's Gospel as recorded in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. The inspired word we're focusing on today is found between verses 13 and 22. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13 through 22. Reading from the King James, it says in the 13th verse, "But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments, contained in ordinances, for to make in him of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were nigh. But through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit." For a few minutes, I'm going to talk from the subject, penetrating prayer, please. Penetrating prayer, please. A saturated church is a church that has a reputation for praying. A saturated church, a prayer-saturated church, is known for prayer penetrating its members. It's not what you think you are. The question is, what are you known for? You say, we are a church of prayer, a praying church. What's the word on the streets? The dopeheads on the corner think we're a praying church. The prostitute neighborhood, they think we're a praying church. What about the dope dealers, dope users? Will they declare that Bethany is a praying church? Doesn't really matter what label you put on yourself. What is your reputation? What are you known for? I told you, the lady who wrote that book, Saturated Church, Saturated with Prayer, Cheryl Sachs, that she was asking God the question, why don't you bring prayer back in school? And said she felt the Spirit challenging her, saying, why are you asking me to put prayer back in school instead of putting prayer back in the church? All right. That we have churches who claim to be the house of God, but too many of them don't know how to pray. I'm so afraid the indictment Jesus gave when he ran the thieves out of the temple says, this is my Father's house. It should be a house of prayer.
Yeah. Yeah,
and you've made it a den of thieves. If you're more concerned with how much money people give you than you are helping them, are you really a praying church?
All right.
And you're trying to change their economic status, whether they change their lives. are you really a praying church?
Yeah.
Today I want to deal with, again, this matter of a praying church, but looking at it from a different perspective. The Apostle Paul gives us this definition of the church, on how it is built in, and I contend he kind of zeroes in on something that's very, very, very pertinent in our today's time. That again, we have too many folk in the church who don't spend enough time with God.
Right.
We have folk who come to worship who have no intentions of talking to God or listening to God. They want to listen to the choir, they'll listen to a preacher, a prayer too, but they really have no intention of having an intimate encounter with God. And there's something wrong when we call ourselves a church and we don't expect to talk with God. There's something wrong when we call ourselves a church and we don't want to have an intimate encounter with the Lord. And then I think I want to tell you that you are not seek to talk to God at church only. Before I pray to him at church, I should pray to him at my house. But so before I try to take him to school, I need to talk with him at my house. Talk to him while you're riding in your car. Talk to him while you're working on your job. You need to learn how to, as Jesus said, pray without ceasing. That maybe before we try to change America, maybe we ought to change the church. We should go back to what we were called to do in the first place. Let me start by talking about then prayer permeated. That in order for a church to be the kind of church God wants us to be, we ought to be a penetrating prayer post, a penetrating prayer place. We ought to be a church that people know us as being praying people. But before we can be praying people, prayer needs to penetrate us.
Come on.
I can't expect it to penetrate Bethany until it first penetrates me.
Yeah.
You are having witness here. Yeah, you got to penetrate the members, then the members together will be a penetrating church, and then it will leak out into the world.
Okay.
Before I can expect the impact then, we need to change some stuff up in here.
All right.
Like one priest said, he had a dream, and the church had a hole in the roof, and it was rain leaking in the roof, and the rain got so high, it started getting higher and higher, and then when they opened up the doors, the rain started running out of the building into the street. I wish I had a witness here. Erase rain out of there and put Holy Ghost in that. The Holy Spirit is raining from on high, and he feels everybody in the house, and the Holy Ghost just can feel, and you're all saturated with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is so bold and so full up in here, and as soon as we open up a window, open up the doors, we start losing out of our very essence. That if we want the world to be changed, we have to admit we don't have the power to change it ourselves. Now we need God to do that. And ain't no sense you trying to think that you're doing it on your wisdom, your knowledge. In fact, one of the biggest problems we have, we are more educated than any group of people at any time in our history, and yet we are more educated, we're more ignorant. We're smarter and we're stupider. We got so much sense, we don't have sense enough to know what we don't got. I need to come to grips with the fact that as smart as I am, as accomplished as I am, as much as I've learned, I still don't know everything. And if I knew everything, one of the things you ought to know that you can't do anything without God. That's what Jesus said. Without me, you can do. Come on here, somebody. So I want my church to be a prayer permeating. I want prayer to just permeate throughout the church. The church environment lends itself to a soaking worshiper, and that worshiper must be soaked with prayer.
Yeah.
I can't meet God until I talk with God. And I can't talk to God until I talk to God. If I want my church to be a prayer-soaked church, it's got to start from the top and work its way down. You can't have a prayer-soaking church if you don't have a prayer-soaked pastor. I got a witness here. It's got to start from the pulpit. I've got to make sure that I've been soaked in prayer. I've got to make sure I see a need for prayer. I need to be praying for Bethany and praying for the members and leadership of Bethany. It has to start at the top. You see, you can't claim you are hot Sunday and you're not preaching from the top. You can't put it to the bottom of the burner. You can't put it on a corner in the calendar. No, you got to put it on the top. If it's important to you, you give it top priority. You can't make it item number 47 and claim it's important to you. If it's important to you, it ought to be number one. Hey, prayer is important because prayer is number one. I can't preach unless I pray. I can't teach unless I pray. I can't work unless I pray. You can't even pray in church unless you pray. You got to pray before you can do anything for God. Because if I'm going to do it right, it has to be God motivated. It all has to be God motivated. I've got to spend time talking with Him. I've got to be God led, God motivated, God. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. But then it don't just stop with the pastor. The leaders ought to buy in on it. If I'm preaching from the pulpit and you don't ever hear it again until next Sunday, you're going to have a showed-up big mess. It's got to start with the leadership. They don't only hear it on Sunday. They hear it at mission on Monday. They hear it at brotherhood on Monday. They hear it at choir rehearsal. They hear it at prayer meeting. They hear it at the teacher's meeting. They hear it in the meeting with the husband. They meet every little meeting, that group, the meeting that meet on the parking lot. When they meet on the parking lot before they start their meeting, they say, let's pray about it. In fact, you know, I find out you're tired of folk gossiping on you and throwing a whole lot of garbage on you. If you want to stop people from emptying their garbage on you, you know what you need to do? When they get through talking all that mess, say, let's pray about it. I guarantee you, you come tell them let's pray about it, they won't be looking you up too often. And if you tell them let's pray about it, they won't call your house too much. If you tell them let's pray about it, they won't have a whole lot to say. The preacher ain't right. You ought to be doing this, that, so, and the other. Tell you know what, you're right. Let's pray about that thing. Find out what God has to say about it. The choir didn't sing the song I wanted them to sing today. I thought they should have been singing that song that Sister So-and-so needs. You know what, let's pray about that. And see, if we can get God to touch the director's heart, and maybe she can get the right kind of attitude, let's pray about that. Maybe God won't touch her, maybe he'll touch her. And then our ears will get more receptive. Instead of talking about what should have been, maybe we can get something from what was said. Maybe the song that was sung was the song we needed to hear. It may not have been what we wanted to hear. It was the song God wanted to use to be a blessing in my life. But then you can't just look for the leadership to have it and carry it. If it's going to work, all the members got to buy in it too. That you and I found out God don't call nobody to bitch membership. That when God puts you on his program, keep the building, don't include sitting on your blessed assurance all the time. The church is the only spectator sport when you got some folk who are tired on the field working hard and a bunch of folks sitting on the bench and doing nothing, and they still, I wish I had a witness there. They still don't want to go in the game. And I think I ought to tell you, because you're not a member of Bethany, you got to buy in it too. Because you made a church, I made the mistake of coming here today. If the pastor and the leaders and the members are praying, you better learn how to pray some too now. You know, when our prayer is contagious. When the Holy Ghost is in control, it gets contagious. That God can't move around you without moving through you. That you may not acknowledge it, but if you're in the presence of God, some things will happen. Do I have a witness here? Paul says that if that thing is properly built, you got to recognize what's going on. First of all, he said you got to have the right foundation. And no, he didn't use your foundation because he's talking from a figurative perspective. He's saying that this thing was built on the prophets and the apostles. But the chief cornerstone is Jesus. I wish I had a witness here. And then he said, then we all on top of that thing. We all in here together. We all in this thing together. In other words, now that you're no longer strangers, you're not farmers. We all are fellow citizens. We all a part of one body.
Yeah.
We all a part of the church. There's no them in the church. They ain't right.
Yeah.
They not doing right.
Yeah.
They ought to do better.
Yeah.
No, it's a we kind of thing. We weren't right.
Yeah.
We need to do better.
Yeah.
We need to improve things.
Yeah. Yeah.
We need to call on the Lord.
Yeah.
And ask him to give us some help.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Well, I understand that. I got an attitude, an atmosphere where God can have his way.
Yeah.
Prayer permeates. See, the problem is, he said, if you don't have it, it's because you haven't asked for it.
Yeah.
And the way you ask for it is you got to pray.
Yeah, yeah.
Ye have not because ye.
Yes,
come on here, somebody. You want more spirit moving in your soul? Ask for it.
Yeah.
You want to feel of a servant? Ask for it. You want a church that's on fire? Ask for it. You want a church with more meaningful ministry? Ask for it. Whatever you want, all you need to do is ask for it. But I think I want to tell you something. Let me put a footnote. Don't ask for stuff that you're not willing to participate in.
Yeah.
God ain't told celestial third errand boy. Whenever you ask God for something, he thinks you want to participate.
Yeah.
And then it comes to pass. If you want heaven to be better, you better be ready to participate. You want to be stronger, you better get stronger. You want to be a more praying church, you better be willing to pray yourself.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
I'm supposed to be through with part number one. Before I go to part number two, let me tell you something. There's something wrong with you saying God is your best friend, but you don't want to talk about it, or talk to him rather, on a regular basis. Yeah, I know. I said the same thing last week. I'm probably going to say the same thing next week.
Yeah.
I got a problem with us always talking about how close we are to God,
yeah,
but you never want to talk to God.
Yeah.
You claim you're close to him, but you never want to. All y'all got phones in your pocket, but you won't call on the Lord. You would text all day long, but you don't even have God on your hand. I wish I had a witness here. He's not even one of your favorite lists, on the list of your favorite callers. He's not on your fan dial. He's not number one, two, or three. He's not even, his name ain't even on that. And you know what? To call on him, you don't even have to pick it up. All you got, all wish I had a witness here. All you got to do is call on him. And then you know he's as easy as God is to turn back. He's the least contact
in
God. I wish I had somebody that you talk to. You gotta learn how to call it more frequently. You ought to call it first thing in the morning. You ought to call it before you get to the bathroom. You ought to call on it while you're in the bathtub. Call on it even while you're on the stoop. Call on it while you're brushing your teeth. Call on it while you're sitting at the breakfast table. Call on it on your way to the car. Call on it on your way to your job. Call on it while you're sitting at the desk. You ought to talk to him more than anybody else you talk to. Yeah, I want a prayer to penetrate your church. I want prayer to permeate through our very essence. I want us to just have prayer on the brain. Whenever something happens, we want to just pray about it. Yeah, you pray too much now. No, you can't pray too much. You see, when you pray, God puts you into action. See, y'all make prayer means closing your eyes, getting on your knees, and bowing your head. But you don't have to be still to pray. You have to be still to know that God is God. But you don't have to be still to pray. You can be praying while you're walking down the street. You can be praying while you're knocking the devil in the head. You can be praying while you're shooting evil. Oh, you can be praying while you're lighting up your life. You can pray even though you're doing God's will. You don't have to stop praying. That's the time to start praying. When he crossed over the Red Sea, when they got to the other side, he said, I'm going to round the army. I want you to raise up that rod. And the same rod that parted the water brought the water back together. And when he round the army, he said, I want y'all to celebrate. Come on here, somebody. Sometimes you got to celebrate before the victory is won.
Yeah.
prayer permeated church, but I see a need to preach peace. You've got to learn how to preach peace. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, this is wordy. This is wordy. I might not preach it all. You see, you got to understand something. He says, Jesus is our peace. So when I'm preaching peace, I'm really preaching Jesus. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Y'all don't see it. That's all good. But no, it's really very critical and crucial to this whole matter of a penetrated, prayer permeated place and church. You see, if I can't preach peace, I'm gonna have a problem with the permeation. You see, in order for a church to be salt with prayer, I already told you, it has to soak one member and pass from member to member. Well, it's difficult, hard, it's impossible to soak all the members when members busy putting up walls. In order for me to get from one to the other, I got to tear the walls down. That's why I got a problem with y'all newly elected official whose name I will not call. But look, he claims to want to bring the country together. But he still wants to build walls. Come on, man. But you can't bring folk together and keep building walls. In fact, when you listen to him, what it sounds like, he wants us to come together on his terms.
Yeah.
Wish I had a witness.
Right.
I tell you, I heard President Moore in his last few months, and I heard the whole 8 years President Obama was in office.
Yeah.
But it's amazing to me how folk want us to give him a chance. And let's see what's going to happen. And my question is, I have no problem with all that, but my question is, why couldn't you give President Obama a chance? One lady had never been to say, how do they expect the new president to work with folk who don't even like him? Yeah. Who don't even want to work with him? Yeah. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Just 8 years ago,
yeah.
You were saying it was President Obama's job.
Come on
here, somebody. To make the Congress support his program.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden you got some new revelation that you can't make folk work with you who do not want to work with you. I'm sorry. I apologize. It's not only true in the political realm. It's also true in the church. How can we unify the church if all we're doing is building walls? The pastor ain't right because the folk, he don't know how to work with people. Well, why are you expecting me to work with folk who don't want to work with me? How could you expect unity for Bethany when most of the folk in Bethany don't want unity? Oh, it got fired up in here. Y'all don't even know how to fake it. Let me tell you something. When I step on your toes, you fake it and say amen. So they don't know who you are. If you can't say amen, say ouch. And they'll get the noise confused and think you saying amen. I wish I had a witness up in here. No, you got a problem when the church claimed to be the church of God, and the church claimed to be together, and the church claimed to be about promoting the kingdom of God, but all you're doing is fussing and fighting. And I heard Jesus say, by this will men know that ye are my disciples because you have loved one for another. I wish I had a witness up in here. I'm in here. Up in here. Now you better learn how to preach some peace. What are you talking about? Now notice Paul's argument. He's talking about the law and love. Yeah, yeah. In other words, you got law. See, a lot of y'all love law. We like rules and regulations. That was the Pharisees. The Pharisees loved law. If they didn't have enough, they'd make a new one today. In fact, but too many days went by, they didn't make a new law.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness here. Yeah, you know how you do it. A girl ain't got no business wearing nothing but a white dress on first Sunday. You can't do this unless you got on a certain uniform. You got to sit in a certain place. You got to act a certain way. You can't really be a part of the church unless you sit in a certain position. You got to do it a certain way in order to be accepted by our church. In order to be a member of our church, you got to wear a certain kind of shoes. And if a man got on shoes too flashy, he ain't right. And you got to have on black clothes, conservative clothes. In fact, you got to have a suit, then you got to have a dress. You ain't supposed to go over here with a t-shirt and some pants on. Don't wear jeans unless it's casual Sunday. And if it's casual Sunday, I don't like the jeans you wear anyway. We can make a whole lot of rules and regulations, but I heard Paul say, rules can divide. See, the problem with laws is that laws really are not beneficial. He said laws don't give life, law gives death. Law does not show you how to do right, it just shows you where you're going wrong. All the law does is tell you you're not right anyway. And the truth of the matter is, none of us keep all of the law. Do I have a witness over here? Paul said you can't do it with laws. Laws is what messed you up. Instead of having the folk coming together and talking about some old laws, we need to come together and talk about some love. Y'all miss it. Y'all in the shout time right there. We don't need more laws. We need more love. We don't need to talk about what's wrong with you because you're not like I am. We need to have love that looks beyond my fault and sees my needs. Homosexuality ain't right, but because you're homosexual don't mean I can't love you. Doesn't mean that you can't come to my church. Don't mean that you can't sing in my choir. Doesn't mean you can't work on God's program. Because just like homosexuality is wrong, adultery is wrong, fornication is wrong. Going to check out how clean your house is. I
shouldn't be coming to your house to see whether it's puddle or not. I should be coming to your house to see if you remember that I still love you.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness up in here. You got to learn how to preach peace. Preach peace in the morning, preach peace in the evening. That every time somebody trying to bring some confusion in, you start telling them about Jesus. Well, just like Jesus forgave me, I should be willing to forgive you.
Yeah.
I don't expect the pastor just to be the only one. All of us ought to be preaching peace.
Yeah.
We ought not be about confusion, we ought to be about harmony.
Yeah.
We should be about dividing. We should be about bringing closer together.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
Y'all been mighty good. I supposed to be through by now. Give me 3 more minutes, and I'm going to try to be finished. I say try so y'all can't say I lie. I want to close today by talking about a passion for prayer.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
Now, if you want to have a penetrating prayer place, if your church is going to be a saturated church, there must be a passion for prayer.
Yeah.
To be known as a penetrating prayer post, worshipers must have a passion for calling on the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
I told you that you can't be who you're supposed to be unless you have communications with the Lord. And I found out that when people are forced to do some things, the outcome is not as good as when they do it willingly. During the 60s, they passed a lot of laws that claim we have our civil rights. Do I have a witness here? We came together and we passed the laws that all men are now really equal. But now we found out the other month that because you passed the law don't mean you solved the problem. Right in this country, we still have hatred, animosity, and negative feelings. Folks just don't like you because of who you are. And I think I want to tell you, we don't need more laws. We just need more love.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need to get on the table with all